So the term structure models we're going to end up with are factor models. And I think it's worth seeing a statistical factor model first before we derive a more complex factor model. This is also just a very useful trick to have in your little bag of tricks. Now here's the idea. We saw in the data that the bonds of various maturity all kind of move together. It sort of screamed something like a level factor, where they all went up and down, and a slope factor, where some went up and others went down. How can we write down a model like that? Well, the yields on 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 bonds, it should look, our model should look something like this. When level goes up, they all go up and down. And when the slope factor goes up, the long ones go up and the short ones go down, or vice versa. That looks a lot like Fama and French's factor model, doesn't it? When the market went up, everybody went up or down. And then when HML or SMB went up, some went up and some went down. And our presumption is that if we did this, we would get a very high R squared with only two factors, just like Fama and French got a very high R squared with only three factors and 25 portfolios. So these are called loadings, the amount by which each yield moves when a factor moves. These things are called the factors, of course, level and curvature. And the other question is, how do you create the factors from the data? Well, we could follow Fama and French. We could create the level factor as the average of all yields, and the slope factor as sort of a HML, are the long ones going up and the short ones going down. And this does in fact yield a tremendously big R squared. The word weights, we use the word weights to say how we form a factor from the underlying yields, the linear combination of yields that cause a factor. Well, rather than just make it up, Fama and French made it up with beautiful intuition, but it would be nice to have a technique that does it for us, and there is one. And so the mathematical problem is, how do you choose the weights, the way you form factors from the data? How do you choose the loadings, the way you have each bond move when a factor moves, in order to maximize the R squared of the factor model? That's a simple mathematical problem, and it has the following mathematical answer. Of course, given the factors, the loadings is easy. It's ordinary least squares regression. That maximizes R squared. But the key question is, how do you calculate the weights? How do you form the factors in a way such that in the second step, the R squared is as high as possible? Here's the answer. Take the covariance matrix of the yields. That's a 5x5 covariance matrix. And eigenvalue decompose it. The eigenvalue decomposition produces that square matrix in terms of these square matrices, Q, lambda, Q prime, and they have the following form. Q is a square matrix with columns, little q. Lambda is diagonal, the matrix of eigenvalues, and Q prime is obviously the prime of Q. And these Qs have another special property. Q, Q prime is Q prime Q is the identity matrix. Their primes are their inverses. Great, you say. So what? I did that in matrix algebra class. Let me show you how useful that is for what we want to do. Suppose you form a vector of factors x by q prime y. Now, what does that mean? That means, for example, the first x is formed by q prime, the first column of q prime y. So we are using here the columns of q as the weights to form the factors from the underlying data. So suppose we form five factors from the underlying data by the columns of Q. Suppose we use the columns of Q as weights to form factors. Those factors will have an interesting property. The covariance matrix of the factors will be, well, it's Q times the covariance matrix, Q prime covariance matrix to Y, Q prime sigma Q. But sigma is itself Q lambda Q prime. Q prime Q is the identity matrix. So the factors, if you form them this way, are uncorrelated with each other. And the variance of the factors is given by the eigenvalues. That's kind of pretty. Well, how do we get from factors back down to the data? Suppose we form y is q times xd. Well, qq prime is y, so that, in fact, is going to work. That is the loadings. That just proves that you recover the y from the x's with q itself. Let's write out that operation. That means the first column of q times the first x, the second of column of q times the second x. Oh, right? The columns of q are now also acting as the loadings that you recover the yields from the factors with. So the eigenvalue decomposition gives you uncorrelated factors. And the columns of Q serve two purposes. They are both the weights by which you form factors from the data, and they are the loadings that tell you how much each data item moves when a factor moves. Furthermore, so let's write out here. Here is again y expressed in terms of all its in terms of the factors with the columns of Q as loadings. The x's are organized, the eigenvalues are organized by size. So this x1 has the biggest variance, that has the next biggest variance, that has the next biggest variance, and each of these x's is uncorrelated with each other. So we've expressed y in terms of the biggest, next biggest, and so forth components. The natural next thing to do is, since many of these eigenvalues will be tiny, suppose we left out some of these guys and just treated them as an error term. Well, the x's are uncorrelated with each other, so you would recover those. Those two are still the ordinary least squares regression coefficients of y on the factors. And the theorem, which I will not prove for you, is that in this process, each of these factors in turn maximizes the possible r squared. So if you threw out these other factors, that would be the single factor that maximizes r squared. That two-factor model is the two-factor model that maximizes r squared, and so on and so forth. So what do you have? You have a very easy to apply technique to create factor models of the sort that you became familiar with Fama and French, where each factor in turn creates a factor model with the highest possible R squared that describes the biggest possible amount of common component. Maybe that'll all become clearer if we go try it in the data, and that's what we'll do next.